We shall commence this module by discussing about the macroeconomic policy. Macroeconomic policies play a useful role in attaining macroeconomic objectives of economic growth, employment, and price stability. Fiscal policy and monetary policy are two important instruments of the macroeconomic policy of a government. Fiscal policy is changes in the taxes and spending pattern of the central government for the purpose of expanding and contracting the level of aggregate demand. Monetary policy is changes in the interest rates and money supply to expand and contract aggregate demand under the control of the central bank, say the Reserve Bank of India, known as RBI in India. Changes in the monetary policy are more frequent and can be made at any time during a year. However, changes in fiscal policy take longer time as it requires parliamentary approval. The interdependence between fiscal policy and monetary policy is considerable. The fiscal policy has a direct impact on the goods market, and the monetary policy has a direct impact on the money markets. The two markets interact with each other, influencing output and interest rates by the simultaneous equilibrium in goods and money markets. Therefore, the present module examines the interdependence of fiscal and monetary policy through the changes in the aggregate demand. After studying this module, you shall be able to understand the need of economic policies in business cycle, to understand the mechanism of fiscal policy, to understand the mechanism of monetary policy, to examine the interdependence of fiscal and monetary policy. Now, we shall discuss the economic policy and business cycles. Market economies have regular fluctuations and do not always work smoothly. The short-term oscillations in economic activity with regard to output, income and prices over time have been called business cycle. It extends over a period of several years. In the phase of high income, output and employment, there is expansion or boom. Recessions are typically short term and are marked by falling employment, output, income, prices and interest rates. Most significantly, it is marked with rising unemployment. The economy will hit a bottom, a trough, and then rebound into recovery. The recovery will enjoy increased employment, output, and income. The classical economists were of the view that an automatic mechanism works to restore stability in the economy. The recession will cure itself and inflation will be automatically controlled. However, the empirical evidence during the 1930s, when severe depression took place in the Western capitalist economies, and also the post-Second World War II period, shows that no such mechanism works to bring about stability in the economy. During the Great Depression in 1936, Keynes argued that the business cycles was due to extreme swings in the total demand for goods and services in an economy, from households, business and government, that is aggregate demand. The intervention of the government to cure recession and inflation by adopting appropriate tools of macroeconomic policy would be required. the economic policies used by the government to even out the extreme fluctuations of the business cycles are called stabilization policies or contracyclical policies. Stabilization is not easy to achieve. It takes policymakers to recognize the existence of the problem, time for them to implement a solution, and more time taken by the economic agents to respond to the policies taken. Thus, the government has two types of policies to control the aggregate demand: fiscal policy and the monetary policy, which are used to stimulate the economy. During a recession, it is said that government is pursuing expansionary economic policies, and when they are used to contract the economy during inflation or overheated expansion, it is said that the government is pursuing contractionary economic policies. Monetary policy can be adjusted more quickly than the fiscal policy, making it useful in stabilizing the economy. However, the economy's macroeconomic management is slower for the monetary changes as compared to the fiscal changes. Now, we will discuss about the fiscal and monetary policies. Mechanism of fiscal policy. Fiscal policy is comprised of a mix of budgetary instruments like the use of taxation and government expenditure to influence the aggregate level of economic activities at the macroeconomic level. It aims to achieve economic objectives with soundness of public finance. The main policy objectives of fiscal policy that takes due account of state of the economy over long term is as follows. First, to mobilize resources for economic growth. Second, to achieve the target of full employment. Third, to restrain the price instability in order to ensure economic stability. And fourth, is to achieve equitable distribution of income and wealth. Government's fiscal policy is used as an active instrument of economic stabilization by minimizing the inflationary as well as recessionary fluctuations in the income by reducing or increasing the aggregate demand. The two mechanisms of fiscal policy are discretionary fiscal policy and automatic stabilizers. The brief reviews of the mechanisms are as follows. First is discretionary fiscal policy. Fiscal policy can be employed either through discretionary or non-discretionary measures. The discretionary elements of fiscal policy are deliberate and focused actions are taken by the government to increase or decrease the aggregate demand. The policy makes changes in taxation and public expenditure policies to meet the recessionary and inflationary situations. At the time of recession, the government's deliberate action is the expansionary fiscal policy, which increases its expenditure or cuts down the taxes or a combination of both. An expansionary fiscal policy is an increase in government spendings or a reduction in taxes aimed at increasing the aggregate output or income. An expansionary fiscal policy based on increase in government expenditure tends to lead to a multiplier effect and crowding out effect. The increased government expenditures mean more transactions, leading to increase in demand for money, which increases the rate of interest. An important question is how to finance the increase in government expenditure. The increase in government expenditure must not be financed by raising the taxes, as it offsets the expansionary effect. Therefore, proper discretionary fiscal policy is to finance the government expenditure, is to borrow from the public in the money market. This increases the interest rates if not administered by the central bank, as investment is inversely related to the rate of interest. The investment will fall and will then partially offset the increase in aggregate expenditure brought about by the increase in the government expenditure. This is called crowding out effect. The expansionary fiscal policy in relation to reduction in taxes increases the aggregate output or income. Second is automatic stabilizers. The second type of fiscal policy is built into the structure of government taxes and expenditures. This is referred to automatic stabilizers. They enact counter-cyclical policy without the lags associated with discretionary policy changes. No political decisions are required, and therefore implementation lags are minimized. It reduces the impact of recession and inflation and helps in ensuring economic stability. The automatic stabilizers ensure a prompter and self-correcting fiscal response. They operate in relation to the business cycle. The built-in stability of taxes and government expenditure of transfer payments and subsidies pattern automatically raises the aggregate demand in times of recession and reduces the aggregate demand at the time of inflation without any deliberate action by the government or parliament. The changes in expenditure and taxes that occur through automatic stabilizers do not shift the aggregate demand curve because they are automatic. The important automatic stabilizers include personal income tax, corporate income tax, transfer payments such as unemployment compensation, social security schemes, and welfare benefits. Moving on to discuss the mechanism of monetary policy. Monetary policy is another policy instrument with which objectives of macroeconomic policy can be achieved. The monetary policy operates through the central bank like Reserve Bank of India in India. It is completely discretionary as it does not require the parliament approval to implement the policy. The central bank signals the market about the availability of credit and interest rates. The key tools that the central bank focuses on the stock of money and credit, the level and structure of interest rates and exchange rates. The primary objective is to ensure price stability, taking due account of the overall economic development of a country. It creates conditions favorable for firms and households and thereby makes an impact contributing to stable economic development. There can be other objectives as well, such as exchange rate stability, safeguarding the balance of external payments, and to maintain financial stability. The principal objective of the monetary policy that takes due account of the economic development over the short or medium term is as follows: to ensure the economic stability at full employment, to achieve price stability, to promote economic growth. The mechanism of monetary policy is to achieve economic and price stability and therefore influencing the aggregate demand in the economy. Our expansionary monetary policy or easy money policy and contractionary monetary policy or tight money policy. It is the changes in interest rate and money supply to expand or contract aggregate demand. The major tools of monetary policy are as follows. A. Open market operations. It refers to the buying and selling of government securities by the central bank with the objective of changing money supply in the money market. An open market purchase by the central bank results in increase in reserves and increase in money supply. The sale of securities by the central bank results in decrease in reserves and decrease in money supply. B. Reserve requirement ratio or cash reserve ratio. It is the ratio of their deposit that the bank have to keep with the central bank. A decrease in the required reserve ratio increases the money supply as banks have more deposits by making loans. An increase in the required reserve ratio decreases the money supply as banks have insufficient deposits. C. Discount rate or bank rate. It is the rate of interest at which the central bank lends funds to the commercial banks. A change in bank rate leads to the change in interest and deposit rates of the commercial banks. The higher the discount rate, the higher the cost of borrowing and the less borrowing by the banks and vice versa. At the time of recession or expansion, monetary policy or easy money policy is adopted. The central bank can increase the money supply by creating additional reserves, by buying government securities, or by reducing the discount rate, or by lowering the required reserve ratio. It is an increase in the money supply leading to increase in aggregate output or income and thus stimulates the economy. An increase in the money supply leads to a lower interest rate. The fall in the rate of interest would encourage the businessmen to borrow more for investment spending. This will increase the investment, which is an important component of aggregate demand. The increase in aggregate demand causes the expansion in aggregate output or income. The expansion policy is used to lift the economy out of recession. Let us now discuss the interdependence of fiscal and monetary policy. Fiscal policy and monetary policy in an country are two macroeconomic stabilization tools. Fiscal policy is changes in the taxing and spending of the government for the purpose of expanding and contracting the level of aggregate demand. Monetary policy is the changes in the interest rate and the money supply to expand and contract the aggregate demand under the control of the central bank. A change in one will influence the effectiveness of the other, and therefore by overall impact of any policy changes in the country depending on the state of the economy and its development. Fiscal policy and monetary policy go hand in hand with each other. Both are independent on each other. Objectives of the fiscal and the monetary policies. Fiscal policy and monetary policy pursue similar objectives. However, the two policies have often been pursued in different countries in different directions. These objectives are common for most economies and can be summarized as promotion of sustainable growth and high employment while maintaining the stable prices. As fiscal policy is taken by the government, they are usually for long term, whereas the money policy is pursued to smooth out cyclical fluctuations in the short term. Monetary policy is pursued to achieve the objective of low inflation to stabilize the economy from output and price shocks. On the other hand, fiscal policy aims toward high growth and employment. For achieving an optimal mix of macroeconomic objectives of price stability and growth, it is necessary that the two policies complement each other. However, the form of complementarity and reciprocity of the policies will vary according to the stage of development of the country's financial market and institutions. It is further important that fiscal and monetary policy implementation do not exploit discretionary freedom but use their instruments in targeted way with the objective of achieving sustainable economic policy. The government pursues fiscal policy to determine the general directions of the monetary policy and, depending upon the monetary control, the fiscal policies have to be devised. The objective of the two policies overlap with each in normal time and thus there is no conflict between the two. Economic policy would achieve stability by reducing uncertainty and thereby would create favorable conditions for economic growth. In the stable environment, the central bank is able to focus entirely on its mandate of maintaining price stability. So, successful monetary policy is predicated on healthy fiscal policy and vice versa. Now, we shall discuss the mechanism of fiscal and monetary policy. The countries face mix of macroeconomic imbalances and thus require consistent mix of fiscal and monetary policy response. The coordination of these policies is important to avoid imbalances. If the expansionary policy of one authority is met by expansionary policies of the other, the two policies are complementary. For instance, during a demand shock at any given price level, aggregate demand rise or fall due to exogenous factors other than price that results in positive demand shocks or negative demand shocks. To correct these shocks, the two policies are complement. Both the authorities follow expansionary policies in case of negative demand shocks to increase the aggregate demand to its original level, while in the case of positive demand shock, they would follow the contractionary policies in order to decrease the excess demand in the economy. The two policies could be conflicting when expansionary policy of one authority is countered by the contractionary policy of the other. For instance, in the case of negative supply shock, that is decrease in the aggregate supply due to the increase in the input prices or decline in the factor productivity, this would decrease the output and increase the prices. The government would follow fiscal expansionary policy to increase the output to its original level, whereas the central bank would follow the contractionary policy so as to reduce the inflation created due to the shortage of output. However, there are many ways fiscal policies affect the monetary policy and thus central banks. Firstly, an expansionary fiscal policy would result in increased budgetary deficits for which the government can choose expansionary monetary policy by resort to the printing press, but this would lead to inflation. The government can even resort to the funding of debt through market sources. There is a possibility of crowding out, and if the domestic debt dependent on foreign funding results in balance of payment or exchange rate problems and worrying to the central bank. This would further lead to banking crisis. the government can even resort to another direct channel, say increasing indirect taxes, value added tax. This would raise the price, leading to the wage spiral and higher inflation. The higher taxation would be compensated by more saving and less consumption. Time lags. Both fiscal policies and monetary policies come across time lags. When policies are activated, this would make the economy work through several rounds of production, income and consumption to realize the results. The recognition and impact lag for each is very much the same. However, the story is a little different for decision and implementation lags for monetary versus fiscal policy. The decision lag for monetary policy tends to be relatively short. Monetary policy decisions are made by the central bank when faced with a business cycle problem. With very little delay, the implementation lag is also relatively short. Policy decisions are implemented immediately, and because monetary policy works through financial markets which operate quickly, implementation is completed in short order. The decision lag for a fiscal policy tends to be relatively long. Fiscal policy decisions are made by the government with parliament approval. The decision on fiscal policy is delayed due to the political decisions, as it has to pass by the parliament. The decision lag continues and the implementation lag also tends to be relatively long. Any changes in government spending or taxes needs to work through the government agencies and administration before implementation, as the government makes sure that necessary rules and procedures are followed. But this tends to lengthen the time needed to implement fiscal policy. Let us now summarize what we have discussed in this module. Macroeconomic policies play a useful role in attaining macroeconomic objectives of economic growth, employment, and price stability. The goal of stabilization policies is to stabilize the business cycle, to counter the fluctuations in the business cycle. In order to be successful, government fiscal policies and central banks' monetary policies must be in coordination to realize the economic objectives. The two mechanisms of fiscal policy are discretionary fiscal policy and automatic stabilizers. The monetary policy operates through key instruments like open market operations, required reserve ratio, and discount rate on the stock of money and credit, the level and structure of interest rates, and the exchange rates. The policies that are used to stimulate the economy during a recession is set to the government in pursuing the expansionary economic policies, and when they are used to contract the economy during inflation, it is said that the government is pursuing contractionary economic policies. Monetary policies can be adjusted more quickly than the fiscal policy, making it useful in stabilizing the economy. However, the economy's macroeconomic management is slower for monetary changes as compared to the fiscal changes. Fiscal and monetary policies pursue similar objectives. Monetary policy is pursued to achieve the objective of low inflation to stabilize the economy from output and price shocks. On the other hand, fiscal policy aims toward high growth and employment. For achieving an optimal mix of macroeconomic objectives of growth and price stability, it is necessary that the two policies complement each other. However, the form of complementarity and the reciprocity of the policies will vary according to the stage of development of the country's financial markets and institutions. The countries face a mix of macroeconomic imbalances and thus require consistent mix of fiscal and monetary policy response. The coordination of these policies is important to avoid imbalances. The two policies can be complement to each other or conflicting depending to the stage of development of the country's financial market and institutions. Both monetary and fiscal policies face time lags. When the policies are initiated, it makes the economy works through numerous rounds of production, income and consumption to realize the results. The recognition and impact lag for each is very much the same. However, the story is a little different for decision and implementation lags for the monetary versus fiscal policy.